Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to tonight's debate. We are very glad to have you all, and for those returning and audience members here tonight, thank you for your ongoing support and continued interest. We hope you'll come again. If this is your first Socratic Club event, welcome and thank you for joining us. We hope you'll attend more of our debates in the future. And for those of us watching via live stream, thank you. We're glad to see you. I'd now like to introduce our first speaker, Dr. Ted Davis. Edward B. Ted Davis is professor of history of science at Messiah College. Best known for studies of Robert Boyle, Dr. Davis edited the Works of Robert Boyle in 14 volumes and a separate edition of Boyle's treatise on God and the Mechanical Philosophy. Author of dozens of articles about the history of science and religion, his study of modern Jonah stories was featured on two BBC radio programs. His current project, supported by the National Science Foundation and the John Templeton Foundation, examines the religious activities and beliefs of prominent American scientists from the period between the two world wars. He also writes bi-weekly columns about science and religion for the BioLogos Forum. Please welcome Dr. Ted Davis.
Opportunity to visit Oregon State. Thank you, Professor Gary Ferngren, Mr. Braden Anderton, and members of the Socratic Club for the invitation to participate in this event. Thank you, Mr. Bernie Dehler. Bernie, where are you?
Up there, okay.
For agreeing to speak on the opposite side. An honest, respectful exchange of views on an important subject gives truth a better chance to be seen, and the Socratic Club has an impressive record of hosting that type of an event. For my part, at least, this will be a conversation aimed at advancing mutual understanding. Pardon me a second. Yeah, I have to get my slides up here. Is Christian belief conducive to doing good science? Yes. I will argue that Christian faith often complements the picture of the world coming from the sciences, helping us to achieve a deeper understanding of both the way the world is and how we should go about understanding it, while providing a powerful motive for investigating nature. The Christian doctrine of creation helps us to understand more of reality than science alone can study, including the very possibility of science itself as a form of knowledge about nature. The tone of my position is no less important than the content. I'm not trying to show that every open-minded, well-informed, rational person must draw the same conclusions that I draw. There are no slam-dunk answers to jump-shot questions. And questions about the existence of God, the intelligibility of nature, or the meaning of life are of just that sort. The enormous success of science in explaining so many features of the natural world is partly a result of its deliberately limiting its methods and scope to things that can be measured and tested against nature, deliberately leaving all other matters to one side, but not debunking those matters as meaningless. Now, Richard Dawkins vehemently disagrees with what I just said. When he asked himself, what is the meaning of life? This was his answer. If science has nothing to say, it's certain that no other discipline can say anything at all. The arrogance of such a claim, dismissing in 17 words the significance of all art, music, literature, and everything else that any person has ever thought about the question, apart from science, is staggering. However, Dawkins doesn't really speak for the whole scientific community when he says such things. He speaks only for himself and those who happen to agree with him. A different opinion comes from the late Peter Medawar, a Nobel laureate biologist who, like Dawkins, did not believe in God. The existence of a limit to science is made clear by its inability to answer childlike questions having to do with first and last things. Questions such as, how did everything begin? What are we here, all here for? What is the point of living? It is not to science, therefore, but to metaphysics, imaginative literature, or religion that we must turn for answers to questions having to do with first and last things. It is to a few of those first and last things that I now turn. And I'll start with a famous statement from the greatest scientist of the last century, Albert Einstein. The most incomprehensible thing about the world is that it is comprehensible. He was referring implicitly to two different aspects of nature, its regularity and the fact that our minds can delve deeply into it, producing a coherent picture of reality. Both are prerequisites for the very possibility of doing science, and they happen to match perfectly with the biblical notion of creation. Now, what exactly do I mean by creation? An idea that might easily be misunderstood if I don't spell it out. Christopher Kaiser, a Harvard-trained astrophysicist and theologian, puts it like this. The basic idea of creation in Scripture is that the entire universe is subject to a code of law which was established at the beginning of time. This idea has two major implications for our view of the world. First, nature functions with a high degree of autonomy. The word autonomy meaning literally having its own laws. And second, the natural world is comprehended by God and therefore comprehensible to human beings created in the divine image. Now, I lack time tonight to expand on Kaiser's claim with specific passages from the Bible and the great theologians. Suffice it to say that the term lex naturae, law of nature, appears very early in Christian thought, no later than the 4th century, when Ambrose used it in his Latin paraphrase of the Hexameron by Basil of Caesarea. Christian theologians made the concept commonplace long before scientists picked up the term. Precisely because it has such strong theological overtones, philosopher of science Nancy Cartwright, a prominent atheist, has even recommended that scientists stop using the language and concept altogether. Without God, there cannot be laws of nature, nor anything else with their crucial characteristics, she has recently said. Cartwright's conclusion flatly contradicts a widely publicized claim made by astrophysicist Lawrence Krauss, a self-described anti-theist. According to Krauss, advances in cosmology and particle physics have made it clear that there's a plausible case for understanding precisely how a universe full of stuff, like the universe we live in, could result literally from creation from nothing by natural processes. And therefore, Krauss concludes, we don't need a creator. Frankly, this is all bluster. Krauss's pronouncement goes far beyond science, immersing him in philosophical and theological waters that are much deeper than he realizes. David Albert, an atheistic philosopher of physics at Columbia, deftly exposed Krauss's astonishing naivete in the New York Times, concluding that none of Krauss's ideas, to quote, amount to anything even remotely in the neighborhood of a creation from nothing, unquote. Or physicist Paul Davis, likewise not a religious person, is equally unimpressed by claims of the source Krauss has made. It is all very well proclaiming that the laws of physics plus cosmic initial conditions explain the universe, but this begs the question of where those laws and conditions came from in the first place. Science may be powerfully successful in explaining the universe, but how do we explain science? Why does science, based on the notion of external laws of physics, work and work so well? Now, many laws are expressed mathematically. This feature of the universe also has strong theological overtones, leading countless Jewish and Christian scientists to quote a creation text from the Book of Wisdom. Thou hast ordered all things in measure and number and weight. In fact, if there's one single verse in Jewish and Christian religious literature that's most often cited by scientists historically, it's probably this. even though it's not in the Protestant or Jewish Bibles. It's apocryphal. Something remarkable is indeed going on here. Many years ago, Nobel laureate Eugene Wigner wrote a famous paper with a fascinating title, The Unreasonable Effectiveness of Mathematics in the Natural Sciences. That really is quite a fascinating title. And the paper's very interesting too. One of the many interesting things he says in the paper is this: the enormous usefulness of mathematics in the natural sciences is something bordering on the mysterious, and there's no rational explanation for it. Now, this is not a trivial point. It's a profound fact about our encounter with the universe, and it cries out for a deeper explanation. If mathematics is merely a human invention, and our minds are nothing more than the product of a blind evolutionary process that guarantees only our survival, not the truth of our mathematical propositions, then why do our equations describe nature so well? As Paul Davis has observed, survival depends on an appreciation of how the world is, not of any hidden underlying order. Certainly, it cannot depend on the hidden order within atomic nuclei or in black holes or in subatomic particles that are produced on Earth only inside particle accelerator machines. This suggests that mathematics has some element of transcendence about it, suggesting in turn the possibility of a transcendent cause of the match between mathematics and matter. Now, whether mathematical or not, scientific laws summarize an enormous body of observations, giving them conceptual shape while helping us to predict the results of future observations. They arise out of the interplay of reason and experience that lies at the heart of modern science. Although few scientists today are aware of it, there are actually deep connections between theism and the idea that we ought to learn about nature first and foremost by observing it, not from pure reason. Living at a time when we're confronted with enormously speculative claims about an inconceivable number of undetectable universes, it's worth remembering something that Galileo's spokesman Salviati said to Simplicio in his famous book about the Copernican system. Namely, our discourses must relate to the sensible world and not to one on paper. One vestige of the theology underlying the modern scientific attitude is the presence in most scientific papers of the two words facts and data. They come from the Latin words meaning made and given, silently reminding us that the facts pertain to the things God has made, and the data are given to us by the author of nature. Now, to take this point further, I call on Alexander Poiré, a Jewish scholar of great erudition, whose influence on the history of science in the last century was nothing short of profound. In fact, OSU professor Anita Guarini and I studied both under a keen disciple of Poiré, the late Richard Westfall, author of the definitive biography of Isaac Newton. And I share Westfall's admiration for Poiré. Reflecting insightfully on the foundational concepts underlying Newton's science, Poiré said this: as we see, empiricism and metaphysics, even a very definite kind of metaphysics, the creationist, are closely linked together. What other means, indeed, but observations and experience can we possibly use for the study of a world freely created by an infinite God? Now, during the scientific revolution, there was a great debate that took place between the empiricists and the rationalists. You perhaps heard about this from a philosophy professor. The rationalists, but there's a crucial theological component to this debate, as I'll show. The rationalists, such as René Descartes and Baruch Spinoza and Gottfried Leibniz, held that reason alone was sufficient to discover the mathematical laws of nature. You heard that right. Reason alone was sufficient to discover the mathematical laws of nature. Like in the next century, a famous mathematician thought that Newton's laws were a priori truth, self-evident. The empiricists, on the other hand, including people like Francis Bacon, Robert Boyle, and Isaac Newton, held that science could not be done in an armchair, that observation and experiment were essential components. Now, this irreducible difference of opinion shines through something that Leibniz told Christian Huygens about Robert Boyle. He said, "Mr. Boyle spends too much time, to be truthful, drawing from an infinity of splendid experiments no other conclusions than those which he could have taken for principles of nature, which one can certify to be true from reason alone, whereas experiments, no matter how numerous, cannot prove them." Now, what did Christian theology have to do with this debate about how science should be done? Well, listen to these words from the preface to Isaac Newton's great book, The Mathematical Principles of Natural Philosophy, the book that launches the kind of physics you studied at the elementary level in college. Here's what it says there. "The business of true philosophy is to derive the natures of things from causes truly existent, and to inquire after those laws on which the great creator actually chose to found this most beautiful frame of the world, not those by which he might have done the same, had he so pleased. Anyone presumptuous enough to think that he can learn the laws of nature from pure reason must either suppose that the world exists by necessity, and by the same necessity follows the laws proposed, if I may interject for a moment, someone along the lines of Max Tegmark, the current cosmologist. Or, if the order of nature was established by the will of God, that he himself, a miserable reptile, can tell what is fittest to be done." Robert Boyle, who was just mentioned in that letter to Leibniz that I quoted, Robert Boyle, who helped create the modern laboratory and its methods, said exactly the same thing. "For if we believe God to be the author of things, it is rational to conceive that he may have made them commensurate rather to his own designs in them than to the notions we men may best be able to frame of them. The author of nature consulted not in the production of things with human capacities, but first made things in such manner as he was pleased to think fit, and afterward left human understanding to speculate as well as they could." So the empirical attitude there should just be obvious. Another example comes from Michael Faraday, one of the most important scientists who has ever lived, and one of the most intensely religious. Cornell historian L. Pierce Williams is author of the standard scientific biography of Faraday. Although Williams himself is an atheist, he notes with admiration how Faraday drew more than strength from his religion. It gave him both a sense of the necessary unity of the universe, derived from the unity and benevolence of its creator, and a profound sense of the fallibility of man. Both are worth stressing. The origins of field theory are to be found in Faraday's detailed experimental researches on electricity, but the speculations and imaginings which led him to publish physical heresies owe something to his unquestioning belief in the unity and interconnections of all phenomena. This belief, in turn, derived from his faith in God as both creator and sustainer of the universe. As with each of these examples, for centuries, Christian theology has been closely linked with a humble attitude toward human knowledge and a genuine openness to finding wholly unanticipated, even seemingly irrational things in nature. And this is surely conducive to doing good science. Indeed, we have an identical opinion from none other than Thomas Henry Huxley, famously known as Darwin's bulldog for his eagerness to defend Darwin's theory of evolution when it was still a brand new idea. He was no Christian. He coined the word agnostic to describe his own position. But he understood that science and Christianity have this in common. Here's what he said famously. "Science seems to me to teach in the highest and strongest manner the great truth which is embodied in the Christian conception of entire surrender to the will of God. Sit down before fact as a little child. Be prepared to give up every preconceived notion. Follow humbly wherever and to whatever abysses nature leads, or you shall learn nothing." The relevance of the Christian understanding of creation for doing science should now be evident, but I will conclude with a complementary observation. Doing science actually enhances the Christian life, making one a better disciple of Jesus Christ. Here, Boyle's palpable excitement in this passage about the telescope. Though heaven be an object that has partly been perpetually and conspicuously exposed to men's view and curiosity for some thousands of years, yet it still affords new subjects for their wonder. And I scarce doubt, but by the farther improvement of telescopes, posterity will have its curiosity gratified by the discovery both of new constellations and of new stars. We need not therefore fear that our admiration of God should expire for want of objects fit to keep it up. That boundless ocean contains a variety of excellent objects that is as little to be exhausted as the creatures that live in the sublunary ocean or lie on the shores that limit it can be numbered. Yet even this passage pales in comparison with the sheer rapture that fills Kepler's works from cover to cover. For it is precisely the universe, which is that book of nature, in which God the Creator has revealed and depicted his essence and what he wills with man in a wordless script. Or as he said on another occasion, since we astronomers are priests of the Most High God with respect to the book of nature, it behooves us that we do not aim at the glory of our own spirit, but above everything else, at the glory of God. Christianity encourages scientists to seek the glory of God and the charitable service of our fellow human beings, rather than self-aggrandizement, which is an ever-present danger for top scientists. As Boyle realized, the higher degree of knowledge that the scientist attains seems more likely to puff him up than to make him humble. And he noted how the challenges of laboratory life could teach one humility instead. This reminds me of Bacon's famous advice about the book of God's word and the book of God's words, namely that we should endeavor an endless progress or proficiency in both. Only let men beware that they apply both to charity, that is to love, and not to swelling, to ego building, to use, and not to ostentation or showing off. And again, that they do not unwisely mingle or confound these learnings together. I close with Boyle's advice to other scientists. In an age when so many allow differences of opinion to degenerate into vulgar name-calling, railing at a man's person or wrangling about his words is a quarrelsome and injurious way of writing that does very much misbecome both a philosopher and a Christian. Thank you for your kindness in listening to my remarks. I will now join with you in listening to my friend Bernie Dehler.
Thank you very much, Dr. Davis. Our second speaker tonight is Mr. Bernie Dehler. Bernie Dehler has worked in the computer industry since 1984, currently as a microprocessor designer. He became an atheist activist after forming a discussion group for atheists and Christians. He has participated in about 15 Portland area Christian/atheist debates held in various churches at the Portland and at the Portland State University campus, which are available online for free to view. He is the president of the Center for Philosophical Naturalism, which promotes a naturalistic worldview. He has a bachelor's degree in electronics engineering and a master in ministry degree. He is the author of the booklet Modern Science and Philosophy Destroy Christian Theology. Please welcome Mr. Bernie Dehler.
Thanks. Okay, I guess my microphone is on. It's good. Okay. So. Okay, this is our topic for today. Who is Bernie Dehler? Who am I? I'm an unknown person to most people probably in the world. So I'll give you a little bit of background. I was raised and confirmed as Roman Catholic. I'm going on 53 years old, just to let you know some of my history here. Through high school, I was a Catholic. In college, I became a born-again evangelical Christian, thanks to Campus Crusade for Christ. We got a bunch of these people here. I was one of those. I preached the gospel on the TV and the internet through a Christian ministry I founded called freegoodnews.com. While I was working in the computer industry, I went to school part-time also and got a master's in ministry degree in 2007. In 2009, after arguing with Christians, because I used to debate different people of different faiths, and Christian or atheism was just another group to debate, I became an atheist because I found out that their arguments were superior, in my opinion. So I became an atheist in 2009, and I've been active in local atheist and secular leadership groups. For example, I founded a group called the Center for Philosophical Naturalism for people who want to learn more about a naturalistic worldview. And when you give up religion, how should you think now? So I try to help people with that. Is Christian belief conducive to doing good science? My answer is no. And in fact, to restate that, just to be more blunt and obvious, I'll say Christian beliefs harm the cause of science. So I want to go on the attack here, and I want to shock you. So, and I'm going to defend this, so make it interesting, right? It's not going to be boring, I hope. Here's, most people will probably find this funny. You know, I think it's a funny joke. I think everybody probably sees this. I mean, here's a scientist saying, here's my hypothesis, here's all my equations, and the middle is, well, a miracle happened here. So the other scientist says, well, I think you should add a little bit more detail here in step two. So why is this funny? Because of course, you can never do this in a science course, ever, right? Your professor would flunk you. You can't do anything like this. You can't say a miracle happened in your scientific hypothesis. My claim is that every single Christian does this. Every single Christian, even Ted. If you're a young Earth creationist, you'll say, hey, humans didn't come about through common descent. God made this as a special action. Boom, there was a miracle right there. Maybe things were happening before that, but boom, there's a miracle. Ted probably accepts, I think he accepts evolutionary theory that humans evolved from animals. He probably accepts almost all of science, or maybe even all science. But you heard him talk about there's these questions. Where did everything come from? Well, you can't answer that. That's evidence for God. Boom, let's put it at the very, very start. A miracle occurs. That's where we get math from. Where do we get math from? Where do we get physics from? From a miracle of God. So he just pushes it. He just pushes it all the way back there. So the most literal Christians are the young Earth creationists. They move that little miracle happens up here, but the people, the more science you accept, you just move that thing back. And you have to do that if you're a Christian, because if you don't, then that means your God is natural. And if your God is natural, he doesn't exist, because what's there to do? If there's nature explains everything, what do you need a God for? So you're forced as a Christian to have that miracle occurs. So my approach to this debate is I could go at it two ways. One is look at how Christian beliefs harm science in the everyday life. For example, people who say, hey, I'd prefer to do faith healing. And their children die. This happens in Oregon. We've had parents have their children die because they want to treat them with faith instead of, you know, medicine. The second way of attacking this problem is looking at the grand scheme of science. That is, science is all about moving the frontier of knowledge about what we know about the world. And that's the one I want to focus on because number one is too easy and number two is very important. Okay, so especially, you know, you college kids are trying to formulate the way you think about things. That's all, I'm going to try to look at the big picture here. So here's a deductive logical proof. I said Christian beliefs harm science. Prove it. Okay, here's a proof. It's a deductive proof. I got two premises and a conclusion. So the first premise is, number one, if God created something through supernatural methods, then science can't figure it out. I think everybody probably agrees with that. In other words, if God said, boom, there's a miracle, humans popped up, of course you can't figure out from science how it happened because it was a miracle. So number two, all Christians believe that God created something from nothing using supernatural methods. Yeah, you can probably argue with that, and that's what the rest of my presentation is going to be about, fleshing this one out. Number three, so if number two is true, number three I think is true, therefore all Christians believe that science can't figure some things out. Because if all Christians believe that God did something from nothing using supernatural methods, then science can't figure it out. So I'll just expand on that a little bit. Again, here's that cartoon. I think you should be more explicit here in step two. Let's take again a young earth creationist who says God made humans by magic. Boom, he spoke it into action. It's an incantation. He said, let there be, and there, boom, there was, there's humans. Or he made it from dirt and breathed life into it, or however he made it. Okay, so if science is unable to figure this out because, let's say that's the way it really happened. Science is unable to figure it out because if humans really were made that way, science can't figure it out because science is only going to cross using natural means. Therefore, it would be futile and stupid for a scientist to try to figure it out because there's no answer. But what happens is the scientists, of course, they assume there is a natural process, and that's how they have so much success. It turns out that they're finding answers. So stated negatively, we can say all Christians have beliefs that are not conducive to doing good science. But since doing good science is kind of the same as increasing our knowledge of the world, because that's the whole point of science, is to understand the world better. We're trying to comprehend what is reality. That's the whole enterprise of science. I'd make a positive statement saying what I do believe, not what I don't believe. Positive statement is, therefore, all Christians have beliefs that harm our ability to gain new knowledge about the world. Here's an example, and I said this is likely something Ted Davis will say, and I think he did say this. The universe seemed, and of course I changed the words a little bit to make it a little bit more sillier, but I mean, I think this is what he's saying essentially. Number one, the universe seems to be fine-tuned for human life. I'm not sure if he used that exact argument, but he might say there seems to be mathematical equations that are amazing. It's impossible to explain this naturally. He actually said that. You can't explain these things naturally. There's no natural explanation for these. Well, if you can't explain it, obviously God did it. That's the leap. It doesn't follow. Just because you can't explain something doesn't mean it's evidence for your side. It's not evidence for either side. In logical fallacies, that's called the appeal to ignorance. When you say, can you explain this? No. Well, therefore, it's evidence for my side. Maybe we will discover an answer, like we did for other scientific questions. Sometimes earlier, humans said, what causes lightning, earthquakes, and tsunamis? And now we know that lightning is caused by electrical differences. Tsunamis and earthquakes are caused by plate tectonics. Maybe another answer is that we'll never understand it because our brains are too simple. For example, in quantum mechanics, we cannot comprehend entangled particles, how they work. The thing with entangled particles is that you can have one particle affect another particle, even if you remove it by many light years. And nothing travels faster than the speed of light. So if something is light years away, it means it takes a year for that light to travel. But if you have these entangled particles and theoretically move them light years apart, when you modify one, the other one modifies. It's a complete mystery in science. Nobody understands it. Some of the physicists says it's like we don't understand anything. We don't even understand the fabric, basic fabric of reality here. So there's a lot we don't know. So don't glory in like, oh, we don't know, therefore, you know, we know almost everything. If we don't know it, then God did it. There's a lot we don't know. We don't know about dark energy and dark matter, and almost all the universe is made out of that. I think it's like 95%. They call it dark because they don't know what it is. The degree of harm that done to science from Christian beliefs depends on what your Christian theology is and what the science is. So, for example, if you say, I'm a scientist and I'm studying the effects of radiation on the body, there's no conflict because the Bible doesn't make any claims on that. If you say, I'm a young earth creationist and I'm studying supernova explosions, you got a big problem because in modern cosmology, there's a supernova that was 12 million light years away, which means it took 12 million years for that light to travel there. But they think the universe is only 6,000 years old. Obviously, the light can't be traveling for 12 million years if the universe is 6,000 years old. That's 100% conflict. So those are the kind of the mixtures. This is just some background on an observed supernova. There's quite a bit of information on a bunch of different supernovas on the internet you can find. Evolutionary creationism is the least conflict with modern science. They're the smartest group of Christians. I went through all the stages. I went as a Christian. I was a young earth creationist, an old earth, and then ID, finally evolutionary creationist, and then finally I said, hey, it just makes sense to be an atheist. This group here, this evolutionary creationists, they, and Dennis Lamour basically wrote the book on it here, they basically accept all science. you know, there's no conflict with the Bible because the Bible is not a textbook. It's not a science textbook. So whatever science tells you, believe it. How does that work with your theology? Well, sometimes they just punch and say, well, go ask a theologian. That's not my problem. That's like Francis Collins, you know, he says, this is evolution. Well, how do you explain this in theology? Well, go ask a theologian. So there's very little science conflict other than, like I said, they still say, well, there's unknowns, like where did laws of physics come from? We don't know, we can't figure it out, therefore God did it. Huge philosophical conflict, so even though there's no scientific problems with evolution, for example, huge philosophical conflicts come into play now. For example, with the problem of evil. It's always been a difficult problem for Christians to answer. How come there's such incredible pain and misery in this earth if there's an all-loving, all-powerful God? And now you want to accept evolution. Well, I'm going to explain how that makes it even worse. And if I wanted to stay this way, I found out I couldn't do this. I couldn't be this kind of Christian. And the reason why is because basically what I saw is that I think they leaned on this logical fallacy of appeal to emotion. Basically, it's all about Jesus. It's about praying to Jesus, getting good feelings from Jesus and your prayer life. Read the Bible for what's good. If you read the Bible and there's a problem, any kind of problem, just put it in the back of your mind. You know, someday you'll go to heaven. All your questions will be answered. Forget about the problems. Focus only on the good and the lovely. That's all you do. And it's like, no, I can't do that. That's not intellectually honest. That's not looking at all the data and dealing. Like, I think, I don't know if it was Faraday you quoted, but sit at the feet of facts and let it teach you. Instead of sitting at the feet of God, sit at the feet of facts and see what it teaches you. Like I said, the problem of evil is greatly magnified after accepting evolution. There's supposed to be an all-loving, all-powerful God, and if he, you know, people like Ted, I think he accepts evolution. To think about this, that, you know, they say evolution is red in tooth and nail. There's an all-loving and all-powerful God who created everything out of the messiest, meanest system you can imagine, which is evolution. Here's a quote from the Smithsonian. Extinction is the complete demise of the species. It takes place when all individuals of the species die out. Extinction has occurred throughout the history of life on Earth. It is the ultimate fate of all species. In fact, it has been estimated that 99.9% of all species that have ever lived on Earth are now extinct. Not 99.9% of all animals that ever lived, of all species that existed. This is almost every single species. Why is God making T-Rexes and all these weird and strange animals and they just all go extinct? It's way before humans even, so you can't say sin caused it, human sin. And I found, too, that Christians are afraid to ask questions. You know, in church, of course, you can't talk about some of these in a lot of churches. They're just taboo subjects. Can you admit, you know, I asked Ted, can you admit to your fellow Christians that Noah's Ark is a myth? That, you know, they say that all humans were killed except for 8 saved on the Ark. We know scientifically that is a myth. Scientifically, for sure, it's a myth. Can you admit that humans evolved from other animals? It's a scientific fact that humans evolved from other animals. There's a theory of evolution trying to explain how it happened, but that it happened is a fact. People, some like Francis Collins, are Christians, evangelical Christians, and they fully accept it, but they get, you know, a very cold shoulder from most Christians. And if you want to ask me in the Q&A time, I can tell you, a lot of people think, oh, the Catholic Church doesn't have a problem with it, but they do have a big problem also with evolution, going back to Adam and Eve beliefs. Okay, so... You know, also, if there's evolution tells us there's no such thing as a first human, there's no such thing as a first fish, first rabbit, first anything. And so, of course, this does a lot of havoc on your theology for Adam and Eve. There is no first Adam and Eve. This is Ted's a professor at Messiah College. This is a statement from his science department. Okay, he says there's no problem between science and religion, and look at his own college. Okay, I got 2 slides here. This first slide is not very bad. Nothing really objectionable here. It says, within biological sciences department, there is no single interpretation that all faculty would endorse, nor should this be surprising. Indeed, the college expects faculty to form their own positions thoughtfully and to communicate these to our students in appropriate ways. In this way, we can offer our students multiple models for relating science and faith, which parallels what we do in other academic disciplines. Now let me show you the killer. Part 2. We believe it's especially important to do this with science, as it reflects a genuine, legitimate diversity of opinion within the Christian community, and better equips students to evaluate information that might not fit neatly into one particular model. College library holdings, which are extensive in the area of science and faith, include many representative examples of each major position found within the Christian community today. These would include young earth creation, often called scientific creationism, varieties of old earth creation, including progressive creation, continuous creation, and theistic evolution, or evolutionary creation, and intelligent design. Young earth creation here is called a genuine, legitimate diversity of opinion. I mean, if you say it's in church, of course you need away with this. But if you say it's in academic circles, this is a scandal. Young earth creationism, that the universe is 6,000 years old, it's just as bad as saying there's a flat earth. It's just as ridiculous. And this is not only tolerated, it's called a legitimate diversity of opinion. And old earth creationism also is anti-evolution. It believes that humans were made in a special creation instead of descending from other animals. This is also a scientific fact taught in every university, state university. No state university teaches young earth creationism or old earth creationism in science. But here a Christian school does. Why does a Christian school do it? This is how Christianity harms science. They're teaching their kids this. So anyway, some people say they read the Bible 20 times and they're really, some people are impressed by that. I'd be more impressed if you read a critical thinking book. And this is one that they use in a lot of universities. It has an interesting title, but it tells you how to evaluate different hypotheses, like creationism versus evolution. I'm not going to have time to talk about this, but the burden of proof is when you make a claim, you need to bring evidence for it. If I said, here I am, Jesus, I return to earth, you should say, show me some evidence, and rightfully so. So, if you believe in a supernatural world, we all agree there's a natural world. If you want to say there's a supernatural world, bring some evidence, and there is no good evidence for it. So I'll just give what I call an inspirational summary, okay? As an atheist, all I can offer you is reality. There's no replacement for a false hope and eternal life. I mean, just to say bluntly, you have to grow up and face the fact that you're mortal. When you die, you go back to nothingness from which you came. For example, like a child that believes in Santa Claus, you can't say, well, I'm going to teach them something else because they're going to have their feelings hurt when they don't believe in Santa. Let me give them something else to believe in that will give them free presents. Sorry, there are no free presents. When you lose your belief in Santa Claus, you can really be hurt as a child. But there's no substitute except for reality. That's not real. That's the same way it is here. It's just accepting reality. But the blessing of reality is you don't have to be perplexed when bad things happen. If the child dies from cancer or there's a car accident and somebody you love dies all of a sudden, how'd that happen? Where's God? There's no mystery if there is no God. It makes perfect sense. The Lord's ways are not mysterious. They're non-existent. And you can really start living and experiencing life instead of some of the people who go way off the deep end, like the Muslims, and they don't care about this life. Let's kill themselves and others because they'll get paradise and there are 72 virgins or whatever. Heaven is the most ultimate Disneyland, and hell is the most ultimate torture chamber. Ultimate good and bad. But when you drop all that stuff, you really start to see how precious this life is and how to experience it. There's a lot of, of course, there's a lot of preachers, too. I think there is a flood of people leaving the faith as the internet and people are sharing their stories. Here's one of the most recent ones, Ryan Bell. He's coming out with a bunch of information now. He just left, and I think there's an interesting quote he had that he said, I used to want a closer relationship to God, and now I just want a closer relationship with reality. So I'll end with that. Thank you. Yeah.
Because I want to look at a couple of them. I went through a couple of them fast, and I want the audience to see if they have any other.
Okay.
Thanks.
Do you want me to flip the screen for you on it? I can do the screen for you.
I'll flip
Okay. Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Dehler. We will now move into the rebuttal section of tonight's debate. We will have each speaker will be given 10 minutes for his rebuttal. That's about it. Dr. Davis, would you like to start us off?
Thank you, Bernie, for a very, excuse me, I gotta turn this back on. Okay, right? Hear me now? Okay. Bernie, thanks for your presentation and for your view of a little bit of your personal story. Perhaps we can talk about that in the discussion together a little more if you wish to. Let me know then if you were beforehand, if you don't want to go further with any of that. Since you put that topic on the table, it might be interesting to look at that. Okay, now, you know, Bernie fired at us a big shotgun full of so many different points. Obviously, if I spent 30 seconds responding to each point, I wouldn't say anything about any one of those points. So I'm going to have to be selective in 10 minutes. And I think I'd like to start with the last point he was on, about statement about teaching origins topics at Messiah College. Partly because I wrote that statement. I wrote it at the request of all of the science faculty at Messiah, and then they edited it a bit and they signed off on it. Every single one agreed with what this says. Okay? It's a collective statement that I drafted. And Bernie was trying to suggest here that the comment about our library holdings, that's what this sentence is about, right? It's about our library holdings. And it says that, and it's about these positions which are found in the community today, and there they are. And that's a statement of fact. That's what our library holdings are, and that's those positions are all found in the Christian community. I don't see anything objectionable there at all from what Bernie was trying to say. Bernie, I think you took that statement out of its context. So I don't think I need to respond further to that one. If you'd like to ask me about that later, you can. Next, I want to come back, you know, and I will say a little more, actually. In terms of teaching the views, I'm going to make a pretty fine distinction here that I think is very important to make. I don't teach students at Messiah College any one of those views, in that I don't tell them what to believe. I think they're smart enough to think for themselves, and that's what I want to do. I want my students to be like me in one respect, not in what I believe the truth is, but in how I arrive at those conclusions. I want to clone the way I approach a question, not the conclusions that I reach. I respect their right to think differently than I think. And I would hope that's true of your faculty here at OSU as well. I teach about many of the views. I teach about all those views that you saw enumerated there. I just finished a unit where I taught about 5 different views held by Christians on these origins topics. And my students will often ask me afterward which ones I think are best, because I want to explain each view as if I were a proponent of it, so that my students understand it very well, and then they can reflect on this themselves and take together all the information they're being given. So that is how I approach things, and I think that's an appropriate way to do it. I think it's a better way to do it, in fact, than it's taught almost anywhere else. Now, as for Christian beliefs harming science, back at the start here, Bernie, you used the famous cartoon that I've used even in one of my columns for BioLogos, from American Scientist, I think. This one, it's a nice little cartoon. But here's what you did. You went through this syllogism. Where is that?
It's back further.
Back further? Further along?
You just passed it a couple of times.
Just passed it?
Prior to the cartoon. Is the cartoon is just
that one?
Okay, now there's one where you talk about...
Yeah, back another slide. Keep going. There you go.
Okay, right, thanks. That's what I want, right.
I got you.
So, I agree with the second statement here. All Christians believe, well, I would say... I wish it were true that all Christians believe that God created something from nothing using supernatural methods. That's not really true as a matter of description. But I believe that is true. Many Christians believe that is true. Third statement, therefore, all Christians believe that science can't figure some things out. I agree with that. But how is that a science stopper? You presented that as if that were a science stopper. That it's futile and stupid to try to figure things out using science. I never said that, I never implied that in any of my comments, and I don't believe that. I don't see how this, three, entails this. I opened my remarks with a quotation from Peter Medawar, one of the greatest biologists of the 20th century. He was an atheist. And Medawar basically says there's things science can't figure out, and those are pretty important. And so I think there are things science can't figure out, pretty important. And I don't think it's futile or stupid to try to figure out using science. I think science can figure out some kinds of things, these ultimate questions. It's beyond the methods that it has. So I don't see that as a science stopper. Believing that that's true about science, that it can't do some things, doesn't require one to be a Christian at all. Medawar wasn't, and it's not silly to think that's true, and it doesn't stop science in any way at all. I'd like to, now if you want to say that there are people who would use miracles to stop scientific inquiry, I think that's true. I think that's particularly true of the scientific creationist position, which almost seems to look like a miracle under every rock. You know, I would agree that there are examples of that. I don't think that's a good way to go about exploring the world, and I didn't suggest that in any of my comments. What the belief three is, in other words, to sum it up, what the belief three is does not, I would say, it does not stop legitimate scientific inquiry at all. What it stops is scientism, the overreaching by some scientists who are basically saying that science is the only way to know anything. And that's what this statement would stop, and I think that should be stopped, and so did Medawar and so did many other people. Now, as to fine-tuning arguments, Bernie, I'd like to give up a half a minute of my time here and have an answer for a deeper, more information here from you, if I could. You seem to think that fine-tuning arguments cause a conflict with science, right? Didn't you put that on one of your slides toward the end? Right, note the evolutionary creationism position, no conflict with science except fine-tuning types of arguments. Please tell me what you have in mind there before I can respond.
I'm over here.
I didn't get that.
Well, like the cosmological argument, you know, the anthropic principle, you know, that.
I'm familiar with the fine-tuning arguments, uh-huh. The anthropic principle, but how does that cause a conflict with science? You say there's no science conflict except fine-tuning arguments.
You can't explain it, so that's evidence for God. If you really think God did that, then why would you bother looking for a natural explanation?
You can look for all the natural explanations you want. I don't see how believing that the universe is fine-tuned, it looks like it was intended to support life and not by accident, which many scientists have said. Lots of secular scientists say that all the time. In fact, I'll quote one of them. The famous mathematician at Institute for Advanced Study, Freeman Dyson, who said the universe looks as though it knew we were coming. Now, Dyson's an agnostic, but as he says, it looks that way. Almost every scientist agrees that the universe looks as though it knew we were coming. So that's not, the question is, what do we make of that? And so how does the belief that this makes sense, if it makes sense that it would be that way within a theistic framework, doesn't prove that God exists. But it makes sense. It makes more sense than in a non-theistic framework, in my opinion. But how's that a science stopper? I just don't see how that's a science stopper, how it conflicts with science. I can't connect those dots. So if you want to connect them in your rebuttal, go ahead. I can't do that. I think that's overreaching again.
The next phase is our dialogue. We can talk more about it.
Okay, perhaps so. All right. Let me see if there's anything else in here I want to respond to in 2 more minutes. Okay, yes. Here we actually agree. We agree. I agree with you, Bernie, that the problem of evil, which is, in my opinion, the most serious philosophical challenge or even theological challenge faced by theism generally and Christian theism specifically, is greatly magnified by theistic evolution. I actually agree with that. I think that if in fact God created organisms through the process of evolution, it makes the problem of evil seem even more serious. Okay, I agree with that. I think the problem of evil is a serious problem, but I don't think atheists get a pass on the problem of evil because I think it creates problems for all of us. Because to take, for example, Richard Dawkins' view, which maybe he's now changed his mind about, maybe you know better than me, but for many years Dawkins has held that evil and good don't exist as categories. And so he thinks then that atheists don't have a problem with evil. I think that's wrong. Because if evil doesn't exist, that's an evil in itself, in my view. Not being able to judge anything as really evil, as a moral category, that's a real problem for me, and I think for many people. And also, how does that, if there's no ultimate evil or good, why indeed should we do what he recommends at the conclusion of his book, The Selfish Gene, where he says that we alone, among these creatures, paraphrasing him, we alone have the ability to rebel, as how he puts it, rebel against our selfish genes. Okay, well, why should we? Why should we rebel if there's no ultimate evil or good category? So that's where I'll end. Thank you.
How much time is this one?
10 minutes.
10 minutes, okay. Okay. Oh, is my microphone on? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Oh, no, it's not on. Okay, sorry. Here we go. Okay, let me back up here. Just put it on here just for someone to look at. Okay. Got a laundry list of things here, and then I guess after this we're going to have an interchange. So I'll just talk about some of the things Ted said, and I want to reply on. Yeah, one thing that's interesting is one of the core arguments I think that Ted had, when he talked about the doctrine of creationism. I mean, wow, doctrine of creationism. The doctrine of creation. The doctrine of creation. Good luck trying to figure out what that is with all the different Christian theologies. Well, sure, every Christian can define it any way they want to. And you'll get all, depending on who you talk to, you'll get a different definition. The Pope, I'm sure, would probably disagree with you. The head of the Baptist Association would probably disagree with you. But they all say they're Christian. One thing you do frequently, I think this is a really big, weakness. You talk a lot about Robert Boyle and Faraday and people that were great scientists, but they died before Darwin came about. And I wonder if they would have changed their mind. You know, Darwin himself, when he went on the Beagle voyage, was a preacher. He was preaching to the crew. He believed in, before he came up with evolution, he was just like all the rest. Darwin's theory changed a lot, and so I think it's unfair to say, oh, there's no conflict with science and religion. Look at all these great scientific people, and most of them are before Darwin. Why don't you talk about modern people? Who's your modern scientist? You know, why don't you talk about Francis Collins? I would find that much more interesting. And of course, you can't say somebody like Hugh Ross, because he would make a mockery of modern science because he didn't accept evolution. You can't say Ken Ham. He's a mockery of science. So you could say maybe Francis Collins, but then all the old earthers and young earthers would say you're a lousy Christian because you have a bad doctrine. Dawkins, meaning of life. What is the meaning of life? Well, there is no meaning of life. It's a stupid question, something like that. Okay, if there is no God, see, Dawkins, I don't agree with everything Dawkins says, okay? But I understand what he's saying here. Basically, you can look at an ant and say, what's the meaning of life for an ant? Well, there's zillions of ants all over the place. They die, they get stepped on, all over the place. Why? There's no meaning for that ant to be there. And people are the same thing. We're creatures in this world. We find ourselves existing. The only thing is, we're different, of course. We have advanced brains. We can look around. We can contemplate, what do we want to get out of life? So we can create our own meaning. And I think Dawkins knows that. We can create our meaning. But he's just trying to say there's no such thing as a transcendent meaning for your life, because there's no God. There's no meaning why you were made, just like There's no meaning for why an ant was made. There's nobody in charge saying there's a meaning. And that's why it's a crazy, that's why he's saying it's an unscientific question or a crazy question. It's like somebody saying, what's the, hey daddy, you know, a child wants to say, hey daddy, what's the meaning of life for that ant? And it's like, there's no meaning of life for that ant. There was no meaning for it. It just came. So it's the same thing with humans. And we create our own meaning because we're sentient and, you know, we like pleasure and don't like pain. And so we try to figure out to maximize this life that we have. Let's see here. Oh, and then Lawrence Krauss, he said that, you know, he... Okay, Lawrence Krauss, you know, again, I can't defend everything he says. Some things I would argue with him about also. But one of the things he's trying to say is that he says that, you know, the Big Bang can explain how everything material came from nothing material before that. There's no material. I mean, what is material? You have electrons going around a neutron and... you know, these higher forms of life appear from the energy as it coalesces from the Big Bang. It all, you know, at the quantum level, you have quantum foam and you have these particles and antiparticles constantly popping out, annihilating each other, but there's more, there's less antiparticles than regular particles, and that's why there's stuff in the universe. So if you say creation from nothing, there was nothing material there. But of course, then the people say, well, that's not really nothing because there's still energy fields. So yeah, maybe there's a multiverse. And it may sound like you're putting down multiverse theory, like multiverse theory was just fanciful. But you know, I went to the ASA conference that we were both in, involved in that organization. It's a Christian organization with technical people in it and science people. And it was at Baylor, and I remember meeting a physicist there. I think you know him, I can't remember his name. Yeah. So we can say Dr. Cleaver. I mean, I was amazed to hear him say, like, yeah, he's pretty sure there's a multiverse out there. And he's an evangelical Christian because he deals in string theory. And so, you know, he just sees the evidence for it. But so I'm kind of surprised for you to dismiss it like it was some kind of godless viewpoint. So sure, certainly maybe the Big Bang did have a beginning. Maybe it came from something else. Like there's a multiverse. And like I said in my presentation, maybe we are too dumb to understand this stuff. 95% of the universe, I think, is dark energy and dark matter. We call it dark because we don't know what it is. We don't know how photons can be entangled and separated light years apart, and yet instantaneously when you change one, the other one changes. We don't know. There's so much we don't know. But we don't have to jump to magic and say, oh, you can't explain it, therefore it's magic. God did it. That's just done throughout all history, and we've seen that God shrink, and I know you're well aware of that. And it was interesting, your Huxley quote, so I was like, yeah, I can agree with Huxley. I think he was saying, he used that analogy of sitting at the feet of God and learning from him, but instead sit at the feet of facts. Yeah, sure. You know, one of my favorite verses when I was a Christian was Jesus said to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and seek and you shall find. And so I figured, okay, you know, if God's real, I'm not going to offend him by learning more. And, you know, if he's not really he kind of did it to himself. He kind of hung himself on that line. And this, so I had the freedom to sit at the feet of facts and draw the conclusion. So, I mean, you gave that, I don't know what your point was actually in giving that metaphor, because to me it sounds like a good thing. Sure, sit at the feet of facts and learn about the world and draw your conclusions. I agree with that completely. I don't know how that's supposed to be anti-atheist or anti-materialism. Well, then you asked about, on my deductive argument, you can't figure out why I said it would be stupid to do science. Well, and then I think we have an agreement here, we understand each other. If a person believes that a miracle happened, for example, the creation of humans was done by a miracle instead of common descent, it would be stupid for that person to try to find out scientifically how it naturally happened, because it didn't naturally happen. So if it was true, supernaturally happened, it would be stupid and futile to waste your time doing that. So science assumes there's a natural answer, and looks for it, and what we've seen through history is that science is very successful, and this is why it grows and it's so popular. Let's see, atheism. Oh, atheism has a problem with evil too, he said. Wow, I don't think so at all. Man, there is no problem of evil if you're an atheist. There's no God in charge. How can you? The problem of evil is a philosophical conflict that there's an all-loving and all-powerful God. That's a concept, a hypothesis. And you see the facts of the world. Again, sit at the feet of the facts. The facts of the world is a bloody mess. And these things don't correspond. How could the most loving, all-powerful God say, I'm going to create all species through the most bloodiest method I can think of, which is evolution? That doesn't make sense. If there is no God, it makes perfect sense, of course. Nature doesn't care, doesn't love, doesn't feel anything. That's all. It all makes perfect sense. So then you make it sound like, well, then there's no good and evil if that's all there is. Well, yeah, there's. I can tell you, I have a foundation. I can tell you my moral foundation. It has nothing to do with that, with God. The moral foundation I have is basically built on three prongs. A prong of consequentialism, reciprocity, and individual rights. And the reason why is because those lead to human flourishing. And that's what morality is all about, is making the best possible society. So you don't need God for this at all. One time, Hitchens was asked about evil, and I like his definition of evil. He says, bad is like if you just do something, if you just hurt somebody, like if you rob somebody and stab them, let's say you stab them and rob them and take their money, that's bad. But evil is when you stab them 100 times, you know, and hack them up and drag them behind your car, and you just keep on going and going and going. It's just like over the top kind of bad. So anyway, I'll leave it with that. My time's up, and we'll have more discussion on whatever you want to talk about.
The speakers will alternate asking questions to one another, and I will allow for free-form discussion in general. Speakers, please try and remain on topic and make answers succinct. You gentlemen might want to start coming up now. Try and make answers succinct. Please try to avoid rambling, and let's try and just stay on topic. I'd also like to remind the audience to please remain respectful of the speakers by remaining silent until the end of the discussion. Let's get set up here, and then we'll start.
Between Bernie and me, right? Or is the audience now?
No, that'll be the next segment.
Okay, thanks.
Questions.
Guess he's talking, yeah.
Okay. Where is it? Bernie, do you have a question for Dr. Davis?
Sure, yeah.
I'm going to love you guys. It's not just like back and forth, but you guys can discuss, so I'll interject if I need to.
Okay, so is it 10 minutes each, or how?
20 minutes. 25 minutes total, and it's not, it's not all one or all the other. I'm just going to let you guys talk.
Okay.
He forgot to bring the chest block.
Okay. I want to make just a quick comment to a pre-comment, I guess, is I think Ted mentioned, he said, my friend Bernie, and I'm really glad he said that. I mean, I'm happy when people say that, because I mean, I think Ted's a nice guy, and I think it's great that we can talk, and I would like to see more of that, and so I really appreciate that, and I'm glad that he said that, and I hope he feels that way. I feel like, you know, I'd like him to be my friend too, so. I'm a former Christian, and I like Christians. I know there's bad Christians, but I guess I never associated with them. So I still have good feelings for Christians, you know. So anyway, I just wanted to put that out there. So for questions, I guess One thing I would like to talk a lot more about is the Messiah College, because I think that's a perfect example of how Christian beliefs are harming science. Because the university is supposed to be a place where kids are taught science, and I can expand on that a little bit on your statement. You made it sound like we have these things, there's these legitimate positions in the Christian community. We have a library where we offer all the positions, and you made it sound like in your classes you go over all the positions, but you don't really say what's right or wrong unless somebody asks you your opinion, and then you might. So if they don't ask, I guess they don't ever hear it. So it sounds like you'd be perfectly fine for Christians that come in to your class as a young earth creationist and leave as a young earth creationist, no problem. But for me, I would see that's a terrible waste of an education. Especially if you know they are young earth creationists. I mean, that's a huge major flaw of science, the science understanding they have. And here they just came in your class and you have no problem with your conscience on that. I don't understand that.
I have no problem with my conscience, Bernie, letting students decide what they think for themselves. And it's not that I don't challenge students' positions. I challenge the position every student brings, whatever that position is. And it's certainly true that over half of the students who come into my classes have a background where they grew up with young earth creationism as the view that they were taught. It's also going to be true that at Oregon State that a significant percentage of students have that same view when they come to Oregon State. It's not simply something isolated to Messiah College. But I teach students about each of these positions, and many of them tell me they've never heard of any of the other ones. Never heard any of the other ones. And likewise, students who've heard other views have almost always heard about young earth creationism because it's so much discussed about it. But they might not have heard of two or three of the other ones I'm going to show. I want the students to understand that they are expected to evaluate a position on the basis of what else they know, including scientific evidence, which they're presented with. But when push comes to shove, I don't have the right, in my view, I don't have the right as a faculty member to impose my position on them and to expect them to leave Messiah College believing exactly what I believe. I think that's intellectually arrogant and indefensible. And there may be faculty members at many schools who do that. And I would say in the same context, it would be indefensible for them to do that.
Okay, can I ask you a clarifying question on that? So let's say, for example, a student comes into your classroom and you know they believe that the universe is 6,000 years old.
Okay.
And you know at the end of the term they leave with the same belief.
Yeah, some of them do.
Okay, and that doesn't bother your conscience at all.
No. Why should it bother my conscience?
Okay, so let me ask a similar question. What if they came in as a flat earther?
Yeah.
And they left your class as a flat earther? Would that bother you at all?
I'd probably be surprised by that bother in that sense. It hasn't happened yet.
Yeah, the reason why you'd be surprised is because the whole level of scientific education in America has risen to the point that nobody believes that anymore. But in academia, it's the same thing as far as the young universe. I mean, in academia, nobody seriously believes this, and yet...
Well, very few people seriously believe. I wouldn't say nobody.
I mean, of course, there's always outliers. I mean, because there's thousands of PhDs in anything, so you can always find one or two that are...
I've asked people about this because, you know, I'm very well connected with scientists, Christian and otherwise, because of what I do and the amount of time I've been doing it. And those in a position to know, which means professional geologists who are Christians and even have their own organization called the Affiliation of Christian Geologists, I know from people in that organization, their own view, which is not measured by polling, but their view in terms of how many people they know that think what, would be that a low single-digit percentage of those Christian geologists they know think the Earth is not more than 10 or 12,000 years old. A low single-digit, somewhere 3, 4, maybe 5% at the most. So among Christian geologists who are professional geologists, it's way under 10%. And it may be as low as 3%, who knows. But it's not very high. So there are some people, it's not none, there are some people who believe that. Just as there are some scientists who are completely secular scientists who don't believe in Big Bang cosmology. There There are some who still think that's not sufficiently evidenced. Mm-hmm. But it's not something that I focus on. Very, very few Christian scientists believe that. Just as very, very few scientists in general believe that.
Well, you said the case is the same at OSU as it is at a psychologist, as far as a kid coming in with an understanding of the universe 6,000 years old and they're not really told how to think. Do you think it's the same thing here at OSU? And I can't imagine that. I think the only reason why it's tolerated at your school is because you're a Christian school, and this is how Christianity is hurting science. Here, if you write a paper in science class about how the universe is 6,000 years old, I'm sure you get an F on it.
What you mean by tolerated is where I would differ with you, in the sense that I respect the student and their right to sort out their own view of things. That's what I respect. And it's not that I tolerate the view. I tolerate many, 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 many views in that sense. It's that I respect the student's right to make that choice about what they think when this is done.
Yeah, but part of the problem is I think you're also respecting the position of the young earth creationism. For example, in your library, I'm assuming your library has books about young earth creationism and why it's legitimate. And you're not really having books about why it's wrong.
We have many, many books why it's wrong. Why would you infer that we wouldn't?
But you also have books of why it's true and
absolutely
promoted, right?
We have a number
so
of
it's,
books.
So it's
I
like,
don't know how many. So I can't put a number on it. But we do have books that argue for creationism.
So if you did a study in your library, do you think a person would come away with the idea that there's a neutral stance on it because there's like equal number of books on both sides? Or do you think it's like mostly against?
No. Most of the works in our library have nothing to do with creationism. And those that do, a large majority of those books would not take a young earth creationist perspective. But we have young earth creationist books. Why should we not? Why should not OSU have young earth creationist books if there are people who want to study that subject? Wouldn't you read the people who write those books?
Not from proponents. I mean, because they're saying this is, it's pseudoscience is what it is.
It may be pseudoscience. I share your view in this case that it's pseudoscience. But shouldn't you have books about pseudoscience and pro-pseudoscience books in the OSU library if people want to study pseudoscience?
Maybe, maybe if it's taught as pseudoscience, yeah. I mean, you got to show this is why it's pseudoscience.
Do you have anything in your library by Emmanuel Velikovsky, for example, I wonder?
Never heard of him.
From the 1950s? Okay, yeah. I won't take that further. But there, he wasn't a creationist, and he wasn't a Christian even. He was a Jewish author. But his books were seen as pseudoscience by people like Carl Sagan back in the 1950s and 60s. He was a very popular author.
My main point here, and I'll let you have the last word on this, my main point is though that you're saying that Christianity is conducive to doing good science and maybe also informs science. So I'm saying your very college is an example about how Christian theology is harming science because the fact that you could have a young earther go there and not feel threatened or challenged or wouldn't even bother you if they left that way, it seems like there's a maybe a passion or understanding for science you don't have even.
Well, you just used two verbs that I want to pick up on, threatened and challenged. If students come through my classes holding that view or any other view, they're going to be challenged unless they decide to come through class with their brain turned off, and then they're not going to do very well. But the threatened is the word that I don't want to use because I don't threaten students.
I don't mean physically threatened, but I mean threatened
the
ideas.
I don't want to threaten students and make them feel like the only conclusion they can possibly reach on this issue and not be stupid, uninformed, or wicked, to paraphrase Richard Dawkins, is the same conclusion that Richard Dawkins reaches. I don't want that to be the case. I don't think that's hospitable. I don't think that's respectful of who the student is.
What?
And I don't think you'd want me to treat you that way if you're one of my classes and you were a young earth creationist. I don't think you'd want me to treat you that way.
I want you to be blunt with me and tell me, I don't want you to play,
Well, can we talk about something else now?
Yeah,
let's talk about something else.
I
want to come back to what you said about Larry Krauss because I think you're just badly mistaken about Krauss. I want to talk about this further. You did point out that Krauss says nothing, the universe may have come from nothing material. Right. But the whole point of creation from nothing, and this is not just a semantic trick, is that nothing is not that which is no thing.
Mm-hmm.
No thing.
I understand.
And equations of modern physics are things. They're
mm-hmm.
very, very specific things.
I understand.
They're not no thing.
Mm-hmm.
And so, quantum theory, quantum cosmology, is a very, very highly specific thing. Mm-hmm. And so when he also cleverly defines the energy of the universe to be zero, which is arbitrary, you end up saying that the universe comes from nothing. That's the clever semantic trick. It's on his part. It's not on the part of any of his critics. He literally does not know what he's talking about on the subject. He knows the physics intimately, but not the leap he's making into other realms where he seems to dismiss the philosophers as knowing nothing. Okay, I think this is a real serious issue. Well, the people in our culture today who really do know nothing about science and religion, okay, nothing about science and religion, are being read and popularized across the world for knowing something about science and religion. And he knows a lot about his own field, but he doesn't know anything about science and religion. He's entitled to his opinion, but he's not entitled to make proclamations of that sort and have people take that seriously as if it were a statement of fact, which is what's going on right now, in my opinion.
Dr. Davis, do you have a question for Dr. Dell in that regard, or do you want to just
I wrote down several things he said in his rebuttal that I
wanted to say. Well, let me make a comment on perhaps what you just said.
Yeah, sure.
I mean, I agree with you. I think he... I see Krauss saying some things I disagree with also. I think he makes some philosophical errors sometimes, but I think it may be possible to defend him that he's just saying nothing as far as nothing physical could be created from just, you know, the energies and the laws of physics and stuff like that. So, but I think even he says that the multiverse theory is a possible theory. So he's not saying that the universe had to pop out of nothing, because the multiverse is something, so it did come from something else in that case. So I think he's just trying to say materially nothing can come, materially something can come out of nothing. But I understand what you're saying. I think we're probably in agreement.
I would say more, but we don't have a lot of time. So let me go to something different. The definition that I used for the doctrine of creation, okay, not again, which was not creationism. That's why I defined it very carefully. The definition I used is from Christopher Kaiser, or his statement, not a definition. He said, the basic idea of creation in scripture is, etc. Christopher Kaiser is about as well qualified to make that statement as anyone in the world. He's a historian of theology who has specialized in the interplay between theology of creation and science. And I think that the people you said who might not agree with him would fully agree with him. I think the Pope would fully agree with him. With Chris Kaiser. I think Southern Baptists would fully agree with Chris Kaiser.
Because it's so general and over-encompassing, it doesn't really say anything? Is that why?
Oh, it's very specific. The basic idea of creation in Scripture is that the entire universe is subject to a code of law which was established at the beginning of time. And anyone want to make two other claims about that?
What does that mean, established at the beginning of time?
How else can you speak as mysteriously as possible about time in that way, right? How else can you do it? Was there a time before there was no time?
This could be a case of pretending to know things you don't really know. Nobody knows the laws of physics, how they came to be.
His statement wasn't about that. Yeah, his statement was simply that about the Christian doctrine of creation.
From the beginning of, there's that one statement he said about the beginning of time or something.
Well, he said, again, the basic idea of creation in Scripture is that the entire universe is subject to a code of law which was established at the beginning of time. Metaphorically, how else can you speak about that?
That's amazing to me to say this is what Scripture teaches. I mean...
If you want me to send you the PDF, I'll send
it. I mean, the young earth creationist thing, Scripture talks about magic. Boom, God said, and boom, there it appeared.
Would a young earth creationist disagree with what I just said? What I just quoted? Kaiser is saying.
Probably not, because it's, like I said, it's you're basically pushing God all the way back now to the lowest common denominator, that he created the, I guess, what's it saying? He just started things off, is all you're saying?
Bernie, I don't think philosophy of science is the lowest common denominator. And so when Chris Kaiser goes on and he says, this idea has two major implications for our view of the world. One, nature functions with a high degree of autonomy, meaning literally having its own laws. And two, the natural world is comprehended by God and therefore comprehensible to human beings created in the divine image. That's a metaphysical claim. That's what the doctrine of creation is. It's a metaphysical claim. but it's not saying nothing. It's saying something pretty profound. You might not believe it. You might think there's no evidence for it. But the claim is saying that there is this created nature. It has a certain characteristic, and it's possible for humans to comprehend it. And here's why. Now, Einstein.
I would disagree with both of those statements. I would.
We can have that difference of opinion. So. But if someone holds the point is the question we're debating tonight is this: is Christian belief conducive to doing good science? And my argument is, yes. And there's a wonderful example of it. That's what the Christian doctrine of creation is about. It's exactly the kind of approach to the universe that you need to understand the world. And that's what Einstein was saying, that the world is comprehensible, and it's a great wonder that it is, that our minds can comprehend it, and that it is comprehensible at all. And Kaiser's saying, well, a classical Christian teaching is that it is comprehensible, it's law-like, and that the human mind can comprehend that. And that's part of the doctrine of creation. The doctrine of creation is about God, humanity, and nature, and that relationship. That's what it's about.
There are so many things I disagree with about that. It's hard to know where to start. I almost have to take it sentence by sentence.
Yeah, that's what you have to do sometimes, isn't it? But your point about modern scientists, everybody post-Darwin, you know, Richard Dawkins thinks that, and Peter Atkins, people like this think that, you know, if it's after 1900 or after Darwin, rather before Darwin, before 1900, it doesn't matter. It's irrelevant to the modern conversation. Crazy. And almost every person I quoted in the first two-thirds of my paper was a 20th century person. And almost all of those were not Christian believers. And they were saying things that supported my argument. So I don't see where that's coming from, your point about all these people, you know, where are all these Christians?
There are people in high school that have more scientific general knowledge than some of these experts you are quoting, because they learn about, you interpret the world differently. If you understand evolution, you can interpret the entire world differently than if you don't know about evolution. These people, Faraday, they could have been creationists.
Faraday probably almost certainly was a creationist.
Okay, and then maybe he would have saw things totally different as a Darwinist. Just like Darwin changed his whole view of the way the whole world worked after he came up with the theory of evolution.
And so he's irrelevant to the issue we were addressing then? How's he irrelevant to the question we were addressing?
Who, like Boyle?
No, the question is Christian belief conducive to doing good science. What about Faraday?
Yeah, but I'm saying you're reaching, evolution was a huge understanding about science and our place in the world and how the world works, and you want to reach back to scientists before all that understanding. Why not just reach back to Neanderthals? I mean, you're reaching back to ignorant people.
And you see, this is part of the problem, Bernie, from the point of view of what I was saying before about people like Krauss and Dawkins and many others who make these pronouncements about science and religion, dismiss the entire tradition of thinking about the world prior to Darwin as irrelevant to the conversation.
It's not irrelevant. I'm just saying, why would you look them up?
It's a scientific bias. It's a scientific bias against the humanistic disciplines and against the questions asked by people in the humanities. Because questions about science and religion, frankly, aren't about science. They're about the humanities. They're not scientific questions. And so when Dawkins is going to be dismissing all of these things people have thought before Darwin, because they're not scientific in some modern sense, he's basically saying they're irrelevant. They're not irrelevant at all. And the kinds of things I was quoting these people as saying beforehand aren't changed one bit by Darwin. How are they changed by Darwin?
Because of
those quotes.
Understanding evolution will change your whole worldview.
It certainly can.
And that's one reason why it's so feared, I think, by Christians. You know, like Ken Ham will say, you know, once you accept evolution, oh my gosh, here goes the Bible, there goes everything. I mean, there's a total freak out.
Yeah, well, you know, Ken Ham and Richard Dawkins are opposite ends of the conversation, very extreme ends. And extremes get most of the exposure. But it also tends to be the case that the truth in many conversations lies somewhere in between.
I don't understand. Why don't you quote modern people? Like Francis Collins is a brilliant man. Why don't you quote him?
Well,
why are you going to Boyle?
In 20 minutes, I had to be very careful about who I quoted and had time to quote. And a large number of the people I quoted aren't Christians at all. I mean, they were saying the same kinds of things that Christians have said.
Okay, I'm just saying it'd be more impressive if you had people of modern knowledge. If you quoted them, you know, it'd be a lot more interesting, I think.
So Nancy Cartwright, the atheist philosopher I quoted, who says, without God, there cannot be laws of nature, nor anything else with their crucial characteristics.
Without God, there cannot be laws of nature, and she doesn't believe in God? How does that make sense?
She's an atheist philosopher, and she says that.
Why?
Without, she wants science to get rid of the notion of laws of nature. because she thinks it's atheistic.
You're saying she's an atheist, and she's saying without God something doesn't make sense. How does that
make
sense?
The notion of natural law makes no sense without God. That's what Nancy Cartwright is saying. And so she's an atheist philosopher. She wants scientists to give up the notion of natural laws. She's even written a book called Why the Laws of Physics Lie.
Okay. I could imagine that natural laws are a very deep philosophical topic, just like time. I mean, people say, does time exist? I mean, there's philosophers who debate that. I mean, they used to think time and space were totally different things, and Einstein said, okay, now they're one thing, there's one fabric, space-time fabric. Time can be warped by gravity. These things blow our mind away, but there are some deep philosophical questions like that. But
that's exactly
it. Looks like the danger here, though, is you're always reaching out into all these unknowns, and this is our evidence for God. I mean,
in terms of the knowns and unknowns, coming back to that fine-tuning issue, it isn't what we don't know. It's what we do know. We do know the universe really looks finely tuned. And so the question naturally comes up, well, why? And as for the multiverse, though, which you brought in, I didn't bring multiverse in except very, very briefly to make one comment about it. Talking about multiverse is a whole different conversation, but let's go there a little, because I don't want my position misunderstood. I never suggested anywhere in the talk that multiverse is godless. I don't believe that, and I didn't say that. What I did say, it's not presently scientific. That's what I strongly hinted at. And I believe that's true. It's not presently scientific. And it might never be such. In fact, I'm going to quote a paper from Nature just 2 months ago, the top science journal in the world, December 2014. George Ellis, one of the top 3 or 4 cosmologists in the world, co-author of the definitive text on general relativity along with Stephen Hawking, and Joe Silk, okay, co-authors of the article. It's an article against Sean Carroll, the cosmologist at MIT, who believes that you should accept the multiverse hypothesis without being able to falsify it through observations. Okay? So as Silk and Ellis point out, if we do, then the rules for doing good science have changed. I'll quote directly from their paper. To do what Carroll wants to do is, this is moving the goalposts. Instead of belief in a scientific theory increasing when observational evidence arises to support it, he, meaning Carroll, suggests that theoretical discoveries alone, my additional word, bolster belief. But conclusions arising logically from mathematics need not apply to the real world. Experiments have proved many beautiful and simple theories wrong. What Ellison and Silk are saying is exactly what I said when I quoted Galileo about we want to believe in a real, in a world of sensibility, not a world on paper.
Yeah, well, I would disagree with.
But see, whether it's.
I mean, I really like Sean Carroll a lot.
I understand, and I
can have a defense of that.
What do you want to make it?
Sure. One thing is.
I think your comments here, the last thing we have in this discussion section, then we'll move to our questions.
Okay. One thing is, I perfectly agree with you that to be good science, it should be tested. But sometimes theories do come up that can't be tested. I mean, like even Einstein's theory of general relativity. I think he came up with a theory first, and then they came out with a test later. And it's the same thing with multiverse. There are people who are proposing ways that could be tested, such as maybe other universes bouncing into ours and causing cosmic bruising, so maybe we can see that in the cosmic microwave background. There are people having clever ideas like that, thinking about how to test it. So it could be possibly test, but nobody's saying believe it based on faith because of math. They're not saying that. They're just saying, here's a hypothesis, let's think about it, maybe we can come up with some tests. So I think that's overstating it when it says, oh, there's no test, so therefore throw it out, and they just want to believe it because of math. No, they're not saying that.
Carol was saying, and so that's what Silk and Ellis were describing. I think it's time for the audience, right?
Thank you guys for your dialogue. When I give the word, if you have a question, by the speaker, please get the appropriate aisle for either speaker. We have 20 minutes total for Q&A, and the time goes by very quickly. We will alternate take asking questions between the two mics. Please have your question ready when you get in line. Time goes by quickly, especially since we only have 20 minutes. So please have your questions ready, maybe written down on a phone or recited. That would be great.
Which mic or which speaker?
Yeah, we have, I'm going to get there. Hey, Jenna, will you take that mic, please? Thank you. Please keep your question short to the point. Please refer. refrain from giving a statement of personal opinion, argument of either of the speakers, or delivering a speech of any kind. We just don't have time for these kind of things. Please also return to your seat right after you give your question. We also have time for follow-up questions. So on the aisle on the right, where it will be questions for Dr. Davis, and the question on the left will be for Dr. Dehler. For Mr. Dehler, sorry. Maybe
don't insult me with the doctor
maybe,
title.
Yeah, sorry, maybe someday. Yeah. So yeah, now you can go. I will see the word for that.
And let me say too, you know, as an atheist, if you want to challenge me, if you're an atheist and you want to challenge me, that's fine too. You don't have to think we're part of the same tribe, so you can't question me, you know? Give me your best shot too, I don't care, right?
Yeah,
sure.
I have a question for the Christian. Do you accept evolution? Do you accept evolution?
Do I accept evolution?
Yes.
Yeah, I think evolution is very probably true.
Good, because that's what my eighth grade science teacher is teaching us in class. And do you believe in Adam and Eve as well?
But we're supposed to go to, if you want to ask another question next time, go to the back of the line. I gave specific instruction. Just pull stuff. Oh, okay.
In consideration of Heisenberg uncertainty, how do you account for order emerging from the potential disorder of the quantum level?
For each of us? I mean, to me, that's, like I said, there are a lot of things we don't know. I mean, nobody knows, I think, that. And like I said, I think 95% of the matter of the universe or the makeup of the universe is dark energy and dark matter. There's a lot of things we don't know. I think you just asked the question, we don't know, but you can't say nobody knows, therefore it's evidence for God.
Well, I don't have a formal theological or philosophical response because I'm not convinced the problem is actually soluble at those levels. Partly because in the Bible, there are at least two different, very, very different approaches to theodicy, to the question of evil. And one of them is the usual response that creationists make to Genesis, to the Genesis creation story, creation and fall story, under which, in their view, all of the suffering and death in the natural world is a direct result of the first human sin, a direct result of the fall of Adam and Eve. That's their interpretation, that's a young Earth creationist interpretation of Genesis. That's, many people think that's the right theodicy, that's the right defense of evil. I use the word theodicy, is that a word you know? I was using it automatically without thinking about it. But theodicy means how do you answer the question that Bernie put about a wise and powerful, a good and powerful God creating a world with not good things in it. Okay, that's theodicy. And so in the young Earth creationist response, it's all result of Adam and Eve sinning. Well, there's a different theodicy in the Bible as well, in my view, in the book of Job. Because in the book of Job, which is, in my opinion, the most profound, theologically profound work in the Bible, Job asked God, if you recall, why is all this happening to him? And God basically pulls rank on Job. And he says, you're not going to know. But, you know, who are you to question me about that? Were you here when I laid the foundations of the earth, etc.? In other words, I think that teaching of that book is, you're not going to know that as to why this is. And I think, is a much more profound theological response to the problem of evil than theodicy based on Genesis.
I have to say that the book of Job as an answer is actually the funniest, most hilarious answer. Because what happens is, in that story, the reader knows why. The reader knows that basically Satan went to God and God said, okay, let's do a little test here. And so then when Job says, why did this happen to me? God didn't say, oh, we just did play a little, you know, like the movie Trading Places, oh, we just did a little test on it. No, he doesn't say. He says, who are you to question me? So I mean, it's like the reader knows why. It was all a test. So anyway, that's just a funny answer when God says, who are you to question me? That's a good way to hide, you know, when you don't have a good answer. It's like, hey, you can't challenge me.
Actually, I like the way Rabbi Dehler put his midrash on that text. I like that. Another rabbi is probably going to put a different midrash on that text. But anyway, to give a more personal response, though, not a philosophical, theological one, although I think one can try to do that. I'm not the person to do it. There's people who think about this a lot. A more personal response is this. C.S. Lewis's book, The Problem of Pain, opens with a page that has an epigraph on it. The epigraph comes from George MacDonald, and it says this: the Son of God suffered unto death, not that men might not suffer, but that their suffering might be like his. Now, in my opinion, the best way to look at a theological response to the problem of evil is to look at the whole story, which includes the future heaven and earth. That's part of the story in the Christian tradition. It's part of the story. You can't just look at it and accuse the tradition of having no resources for this issue, and then ignore half the resources. So that's part of the story, but it's also part of the story that the maker of heaven and earth in Trinitarian theology, the maker of heaven and earth, is Jesus. John's Gospel, the prologue of John's Gospel, says that the Word was with God, the Word was God, and without Him was not anything made that was made. If the second person of the Trinity, the crucified God, Him whom we crucify is the maker of heaven and earth, then the world might not look quite as surprisingly different if it has a cruciform shape. And that's what I would suggest as a more personal response to this. It's also somewhat theological, though I'm not the person to develop that theology. I'm no theologian.
I gotta say, I just think that's also a funny answer. I'm doing a debate at Portland State University next month. It's all about the gospel. Does the gospel make any sense? You know. There's a problem here with sin on the world, and God says, okay, I got a good plan, I'm gonna go down there and kill myself to solve it. It's just a funny answer. It's when you understand why is there a sin sacrifice, and you see the pagan roots of it, it seems obvious to me that Moses came up with it and he got it from his pagan neighbors. It's like, the gods are angry, of course we have to make a sacrifice. That was the whole root of it. This whole thing about God killing and coming down the earth and killing himself to appease his own wrath, this doesn't make any sense when you think about
it. Well, that's
nice. I'm sorry, gentlemen, we're going to have other questions. This is a great conversation. We got other questions, though.
Luckily, my question ties into that, kind of. Just if it becomes a problem for a Christian to believe in evolution because there's death in evolution, it's red by tooth and nail, so there's evil, how is natural death necessarily evil? To an atheist, like how does death take on an evil personality, especially evil defined by how you defined it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so basically the question is, if there is no God, then what is good and bad, what is evil? Is that kind of the question? Why do you call something evil if there is no God?
Like, how is evolution a problem for a Christian because it says God must somehow be bad or evil for death to result, and like, how is death evil?
Okay, well, the problem is stated that it's a philosophical contradiction that God is supposed to be all-loving and all-powerful, and yet that's not what we see in nature if you believe in evolution. For an atheist, you can't say that's just the way nature is. If I say nature is evil, what I mean by that, I use a word, like I said, I kind of like the way Hitchens defined the word evil. He said, you know, bad is when, you know, you got some pain, but evil is when you go over the top. So, like, there's this one famous YouTube video, it just comes up on my mind for some reason, like, it's called something at Kruger Valley or something, you might have seen it, where this little buffalo is by the herd, and some lions attack it, and they drag it down, they're trying to kill it, and they go in the water, and then the next thing, a crocodile comes in there and starts getting it, and then the other buffalo come, and they come back and rescue it, and somehow that thing survived it and came out. It's like, that's just that's just nature, how it works. There's so much evil and ideas of just pain and suffering. It's just over the top. But yeah, I'm not blaming God for it or anything. That's just life. That's just, I would call it evil because it's so painful. But I'm not saying it's evil like there's a Satan behind it or something. I'm just using the word evil to show how over the top torturous it is. So.
No, we've talked about that.
I think it's funny, Bernie, how you mentioned the ant and how unimportant it was, and you made it important by doing so. At any rate, my question is for you, Dr. Davis. Certainly, you admit that archaeology and anthropology is a science, right? And that history is part of that. So
we have
anthropologists, archaeologists who've searched high and low over Israel for the remains of the Temple of Solomon and the Palace of David, and they've never been found. It's not, archaeologists have concluded pretty much they don't exist in Judea today. But it does appear, at least to some archaeologists, that they do exist in Egypt right now. But the question is then, is good science conducive to belief in Christianity? If it turns out that so much of the Bible really has no factual basis, we've got Christians, Jews, Muslims, all in contention over Egypt, where this might be. How did those groups and their beliefs help science to find out whether that really is the Temple of Solomon in Egypt? Question mark.
Well, I'm not familiar with that specific claim about the Temple of Solomon, so I can't respond to that as a specific claim. But the general thing about archaeology, I will comment on that. I think archaeology can be classified as a science in a certain sense, probably more scientific than some other disciplines in social science. But archaeology is a science in which one of the premises you always have to keep in mind is that the absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. And so you never know what you're going to find the next year. And now, at some point, you wonder, how long can you make such an argument? But there's many areas of the world, and many areas in the Middle East have never been dug and never explored. So I don't know about those specifics.
Aren't the beliefs what keep people from looking?
I don't think so. Now, with regard, let me give an example here. The very famous archaeologist Israel Finkelstein, as you may know, famously said that David and Solomon did not exist. And when the stele was found from the Syrians that had the house of Dawood on it, he had to back away and admit that at least there had probably been some prince or king David at that point, historically. And more of the same can come, depending on what claims of Finkelstein's one's looking at. You know, Finkelstein doesn't think Nazareth was very, basically nothing in the first century. He was wrong about that. And so there's other kinds of things. Wait till the story comes through. But I don't think you need to confirm every fact of the Bible from archaeology. In fact, in some cases, you seem to disconfirm them. It's really hard to make sense of Jericho, for example, the Jericho story. It's very hard to make sense of that in light of archaeological evidence.
Yeah, I don't really have a comment on it. Part of it is I just lost all interest in the Bible. I mean, to me, the Bible's kind of on par with Harry Potter or Star Wars. I lost so much respect for it. It's hard to take any of it seriously for myself. I mean, like the Gospels, Bart Ehrman says the Gospels are anonymously written, and here this is something that everything you know about Jesus, his life and everything, is from these anonymous Gospels. I don't even want to waste my time with it anymore.
All right, we're going to keep going. We've got a lot of questions. Yeah. Go ahead.
Hey, thank you for coming. I wanted to ask, if there is no God, why is it that in nature you can find geometry, very beautiful geometry, all over the place?
That's like, isn't that like saying where the laws of physics come from? It's the same kind of question. Where did math come from? Geometry is beautiful. How do you explain that? I mean,
No, we're going to keep moving on. I'm sorry, I said, you got to listen to what I said. I'm sorry.
Well, maybe you're just expressing that there's art, and art is beautiful. Where does that come from? I mean, humans have appreciation. I don't understand how that has anything to do with God.
Well, there is an interesting point there, though, I think it's being raised. Paul Dirac, probably the greatest mathematical physicist in England in the 20th century, who was no believer in God, as far as I know, was very famous for basically saying God used beautiful mathematics in the creation. And his point was that certain kinds of mathematics, not just ordinary run-of-the-mill, draw-in-the-sand mathematics like the Greeks were doing, but really sophisticated mathematics with complex numbers and crazy things like that in it, were necessary for understanding nature way down deep. Why was that true? Why did God choose beautiful mathematics? That's an interesting question.
And it's kind of interesting too, because string theory, you might say, is really amazing, beautiful stuff, and they don't know if it's true or not yet.
That's
so
right.
It can be just a math game.
We got like 2 minutes, and I'd like to get as many questions as we can. Can we? Yeah, thanks, man.
Hi, my name is Matt, and I'm the president of this Advocates for Freethought and Skepticism, which is the Secular Student Alliance affiliate on campus. Dr. Davis, thank you for coming tonight. Arguing that science can or cannot answer every question or explain every phenomenon seems to be asking the wrong question and really missing the point. Of course, there are some issues that science may be unable to address, but these are what we look to with philosophy and other such fields with human experience and exploration. Sir, secular individuals can do bad science and make bad arguments all the time, but there's nothing about secular perspectives that introduce, require, or otherwise make extra room for this bad science to be possible. Christianity, again, seems to be an introduced and unnecessary variable here, and as such creates the potential for that kind of bad science. How does this make it conducive to good science or human progress more generally?
I don't agree with your premise that secular science can introduce bad ideas and bad principles that might even be science doctrines. Let me give you an historical example, a relevant one. When Charles Darwin was a young man, he was not working in biology, as we would say today. He was working in geology. That word existed at the time, and that's what he thought of himself as a geologist. That word existed too, and one of the phenomena he studied is in Scotland. It's a series of parallel roads scraped into rock by a glacial lake. And it's called the Parallel Roads of Glen Roy. Darwin wrote a very interesting paper interpreting those where he completely missed the right explanation. The right explanation was a result of the glacial age. And the reason he missed it, even though people were talking about glaciers at the time, is because he, following Charles Lyell, simply believed a priori that things like glacier ice ages had never been here. They couldn't have been here because they're not here now. So his assumption from Lyell that you must take present forces and present kinds of processes and extrapolate them into the past and use nothing else ruled out glacial ages and ruled out Lyell's case, comets colliding with the Earth, such as the hypothesis of Alvarez to explain the extinction of the dinosaurs and other such things. My point is simply to say, secular views and ideological views imposed on science can also be science doctrines. They can limit science.
That's what I said.
Yeah. But that sounded to me like what you were saying, like Christianity introduces these anti-scientific factors, these sort of science doctrine factors. If I misheard his question, could I ask him to repeat it?
I think he said that the question was whether Christianity introduces a new problem, the existence of God, into the equations of science that don't necessarily need it, and whether that introduction causes problems for good science.
That's like that's Occam's razor, where you're putting unnecessary extra hypotheses in there.
Okay, thanks for clarifying that. I did mishear your question. Okay.
So basically,
why? If you're a young Earth creationist, I understand why you're making God into a competition with science hypothesis. Where did I do that tonight?
I'm not supposed to give more information.
Oh, okay. I'll ask it rhetorically. Where did I do that tonight?
Yeah, you said, where did you do that? I think when you're saying things like, you're giving credit to God for things that started. You're saying, I don't know, the laws of physics, I think, or math. There was some kind of start at some point, so you're positing a God, and so this is positing this extra thing.
Okay,
so,
what I was doing is not science. I didn't offer it as science. I didn't suggest that God is a scientific hypothesis. I don't actually believe that. Like Dawkins believes it, I don't. I think Dawkins is wrong. God is not a scientific hypothesis. I was asking a larger philosophical, metaphysical question about science. So I was stepping out of the realm of science right there. But I was asking a larger question about science around the boundary edge.
But if you seriously believe that God...
I want to go for this last question. That way we can end it up. So one more question and then we're going to go.
Thank you. Mr. Dehler, you mentioned Francis Collins a few times, whom you might say is a Christian who does good science today. One of your slides pointed out that for areas of science not contradicting the Bible, there's no conflict. And it goes to, for areas of science that a person believes contradicts the Bible, for them there might be a lot of conflict. And I'm wondering if you would say Christianity is conducive to good science for those believers who are not seeing their endeavor of science as in conflict with the Bible, but it's not conducive to good science in the cases where believers are seeing some part of the Bible as directing their things. And so, in fact, in some cases it is, and in some cases it isn't.
Yeah, well, to restate, I want to make the bold statement that all Christians do have conflict. And for Francis Collins, for example, I think he would be like Ted and have an argument from the very start somewhere, like the laws of physics or something. And so he says it's not a science. Where did the laws of physics come from? Well, they came from God. Nature cannot explain that. Is that right? Okay, so that means you're never going to look for a natural explanation because maybe you believe nature cannot explain it. Why would you look for a natural explanation there? That's what science is all about, looking for natural explanations. Maybe there is a natural explanation for how physics came to be, but they're not going to find it. That's not conducive to doing science, because that's where their miracle happens.
See, it's again, you're accusing this belief in this belief about in which to place science, contextualize science, this belief in a prior entity, God. You're confusing that with doing science as a science stopper. I've not done that anywhere in my presentation. I've never suggested that. I suggested there are certain questions that go beyond science, and that those questions are meaningful questions, and that one way of answering those questions in a meaningful way is Christian theism. That it makes sense of science in many ways, science itself. And therefore it's conducive to doing good science.
The only reason why you're going to God for natural laws is because there's no natural answer for it. If that's what it is, that's just God of the gaps. You know, that's the traditional God of the gaps thinking. That's the big enemy of science throughout of all of history. That God is shrinking and shrinking as science develops. Can't explain it. We don't know. Must be God did that part then.
This isn't about God filling gaps in a sense, some gaps that some science is going to step into. This isn't like saying we shouldn't explore this, and so therefore, because we're afraid we're going to have our God disappear. It's asking larger questions about what we already know about the universe, not what we don't know, but what we do know. Questions about why is it that they have this form, not that form? I mean, an example here let me quote about Paul Davis again.
Quotes are not necessarily a great opportunity right now. Mr. Dehler, would you like to make a quick comment, and then we're going to move on to closing statements?
I think we both had a closing comment on there, so.
Okay, do you?
I think we're okay.
We have 3 to 5 minutes.
Yeah. You mean it's time for closing comments now?
Sure. Closing comments.
Yeah, sure. Okay. I guess I just want to summarize the discussion tonight. I want to reiterate that, so Ted is in the position of saying that there is no conflict. I mean, Christianity is supposed to be conducive to doing good science. And to me, I think as citizens of America, we should be shocked and amazed and disappointed that he works at a university that is fine with people who come in with young earth creationist ideas, thinking that it's perfectly fine. They invented their own kind of science called creation science. That's how bad it is. Creation science. They had to create a brand new field of science because it conflicts with modern science. Somehow his university wants to tolerate this and say, and not put people, not, I don't know, it just, he made it sound like it's the same thing with OSU, that if you had young earth creationists beliefs, you probably wouldn't feel challenged here. I don't get it. I don't understand that. I think OSU would be hugely different than Messiah College. If you're a creationist coming as a young earth creationist at OSU, going to a geology class, I bet it's 9-day difference in going to Messiah College, night and day. It has to be. If it doesn't bother you that a student would leave your university with a degree thinking that young earth creationism is legitimate, I mean, that should be shocking. That just should be shocking. And so here it's not shocking to you, and you're arguing that Christianity is conducive to good science. I mean, I don't understand how you can be in that position when you have that such low tolerance for pseudoscience. That's what it is, a pseudoscience. Pseudo means fake. It's fake science. I have zero toleration for that. It's so disgusting on a scientific level, the young earth creationism. It's disgusting. It is so disgusting intellectually, and it doesn't bother you. It's like, where is your feeling for science? I mean, it's just amazing. It should be appalling. And the reason why it's not appalling to you is because you're a Christian with Christian beliefs, and you know the Christian community has strong beliefs about this, I think you don't want to step on some toes or something. I don't know. That's where I'll leave it, I guess. Can I show some emotion?
Okay, well, just I didn't have any prepared closing argument, but I will make some closing remarks. Again, Bernie is not hearing everything I'm saying in the nuanced way that I'm saying it. I'm not saying it in a nuanced way so that I can't be caught. I'm saying it in a nuanced way because that's how I think about it. I am deeply disturbed by scientific creationism itself, by the set of propositions that one proposes that people need to believe in order to be Christians. I think that is completely wrong in the way it approaches the scientific issues. It doesn't accept the legitimacy of the historical sciences at all. I think that's where the most fundamental issue is. And I do. I think the historical sciences are quite legitimate. Cosmology, paleontology, evolutionary biology. And I try to teach students to understand what historical science is about. Many, many students at OSU probably don't. When they come through a science class, I wonder how many really understand what a historical science is. Perhaps it's not emphasized. If it's typical at university teaching for students who aren't majoring in one of these disciplines, I think very few students come away with these kinds of deeper philosophical understandings of science. I think they tend to view science as something you have to get past. That's not a commentary on OSU, it's a commentary on the students and their attitude in class. But I am deeply disturbed by scientific creationism and the fact that it's so popular. I do not want to see it increase in popularity. I'd like to see it greatly decrease. But I am not so disturbed by the views that I'm going to browbeat my students to get it out of them. If students decide that scientific creationism is not true based on something they learn in one of my classes, I'm not going to be disappointed about that. But if a bright, well-informed student leaves my class as a scientific creationist, as a well-informed person on the rest of the issues, and has decided to believe this for certain reasons, I'm in no position to be disappointed with how they arrived at that conclusion, if they've thought it through. There, you know, Paul Nelson, for example, is a creationist. He's a philosopher trained at the University of Chicago in philosophy of science at a very high level. He has a doctorate in it. He is a young earth creationist for reasons of theodicy, reasons that we came back to earlier. He cannot reconcile to himself the existence of suffering and death prior to Adam and Eve. He can't reconcile that. That's his reason. Now, you might think that's a bad reason, or you might think that he shouldn't be a creationist, but he's thought about it pretty deeply. He's come to a conclusion. And he could, if he were here debating you on that topic, I think he'd make a pretty good case for why he's not so stupid to believe that, okay? But I am not going to browbeat my students into a position that they don't want to believe. I'm going to try to persuade students to think about an issue in a broad way and consider as much knowledge as they can in coming to a conclusion. But what I was trying to argue tonight, I did not make a natural theological argument tonight. I did not try to argue for the existence of God. That's a different order. The last time I was here 5 years ago, I did that, when the question was, is nature all there is? I'm capable of making a natural theological argument. But I did not do that tonight. I addressed the question, is Christian belief conducive to doing good science? And I think I demonstrated very well that it is, has been, and still is, because these questions are still there, and the Christian doctrine of creation is still what it has been. And there's very wide agreement about that. If you were to say that Christians can use God as a science stopper, I would fully agree. Christians can do that, just as other people can use other things as science stoppers as well, as I indicated with the Darwin example. And I don't think they ought to do that. I think that's misguided. But that's not a very, very large percentage. It's a very small percentage of Christians who are actually in science who actually do that. Nearly all of the creationists in this country are not scientists, including Ken Ham, president of Answers in Genesis. He's not a scientist. And only a very, very small number of Christians who actually practice science in this country are scientific creationists. So I think you're looking at that group to represent a view that is not a widely held view among Christians who are real scientists.
Thank you very much, Dr. Davis. Thank you again for joining us tonight. Just a reminder, we have a small library in the Talisman Room of the MU where you can check out books related to previous debate topics, and you can get involved with our book clubs if you'd like to discuss more on the Christian faith. If you'd like to be kept up to date with the Socratic Club, follow us on Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram, or sign up for the email list in the lobby at the table. One last round of applause for our debaters. Thank you.